बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम। दिस इज़ डॉक्टर सैयद कसवर अली शाह, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ जूलॉजी, चौलिस्तान यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ वेटनरी एंड एनिमल साइंसेज, बहावलपुर। टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस एविडेंसेज ऑफ एवोल्यूशन, पार्टिकुलरली एविडेंसेज ऑफ एवोल्यूशन फ्रॉम पैलेंटोलॉजी। पैलेंटोलॉजी एज वी नो दिस इज़ द स्टडी ऑफ द फॉसिल्स, एंड फॉसिल्स गिव अस डायरेक्ट एविडेंस ऑफ अकरेंस ऑफ एवोल्यूशन, एज फॉसिल्स आर द डेड पेट्रीफाइड रिमेन्स ऑफ ऑर्गेनिज्म प्रिजर्व्ड इन रॉक्स। सो फ्रॉम द fossils we can trace the history of evolution of particular organism. If we see the history of paleontology, the name of Leonardo da Vinci is very much famous in the history of paleontology. Leonardo da Vinci, he was a very versatile personality, so he was also a versatile artist. He is famous for the very famous painting Mona Lisa, which lies in the Louvre Museum, Paris. And now we are discussing Leonardo da Vinci as a paleontologist, as a scientist. He studied the fossils. He particularly studied the fossils of the mollusks. He studied shells, teeth, bones, and other parts of the animals buried in the rocks. Some part of the fossils resemble the living organisms. So fossils were remains of animals existed in remote past, although some of them they are extant. So here in the picture we can see various type of the shells of the mollusks which Leonardo da Vinci found from the rocks. So next is the Georges Cuvier. Georges Cuvier, he was a French guy. He is regarded as founder of paleontology, and he is famous for his theory of catastrophism. So according to him, succession of catastrophes like fires, floods, volcanoes, pandemics, etc. destroy the living creatures, followed by origin of new and higher type of organisms. So he is also famous for his principle of correlations. According to him, all organs in the body of an animal are deeply interdependent. Species existence rely on the way in which these organs interact. For example, if animal teeth are adapted for carnivorous mode of life, without examination we could be sure that its digestive system will also be adapted for digestion of flesh. So its skeleton, its locomotory organs, its sense organs, all are arranged in such a way to make it successful to at pursuing and catching the prey. If things were not so, organism cannot survive. For example, if a species has digestive tract adapted to digest the flesh and the body skeleton is adapted to foraging plants, it cannot survive. So it means the organism body and its mode of life, they are correlated. So different organs, they are correlated. If the skeleton is adapted for carnivorous mode of life, its digestive system, its anatomy, its physiology is also adapted for carnivorous mode of life, and so on. So then is the theory of uniformitarianism. So this theory was formulated by James Hutton and Charles Lyell. James Hutton, he says that the present is the key to the past. So the erosion of landform, the deposition of sediments, the drifting of continents, and the eruption of the volcanoes, all of those were happening long ago, roughly at the same scale and at the same rate as are now. So according to him, this evolution is a uniform process. As different forces are acting now, they were also acting in the past. So they are acting on the organisms, and organisms, they gradually evolve into new forms. The Charles Lyell, he seconded this idea of uniformitarianism. So Hutton ideas did not gain major support of the scientific community until the work of Sir Charles Lyell. In the three volumes publication, Principles of Geology, the Lyell presented a variety of geological evidences from various parts of the world, particularly the Europe like England, France, Italy, and Spain, to prove Hutton's ideas correct and to reject the theory of catastrophism. So Hutton and Lyell, they were supporter of theory of uniformitarianism. They opposed the catastrophism, and they say that this process is a uniform process occurring since long, since the beginning of the planet. So paleontology, as it is the study of the fossils. Fossils, which are the actual remains or traces of the organism that lived in the ancient geological times. So they give us the visual evidence of evolution. For example, if we see the fossils. So we can trace the life history of the fossil, the life of the fossils by various type of the mechanisms like radioactive methods. So prokaryotes, which are considered as the ancestors of all life forms. So bacteria, they precede all eukaryotic life in the fossil records. So the most primitive fossils belong to the prokaryotes, and then are the simple eukaryotes, and then multicellular eukaryotes, and so on. So from the fossils, we can have the actual visual evidence of evolution. So similarly, different vertebrate classes of the fossils appeared chronologically. For example, fossil of the fish are ancient, followed by the amphibians, then reptiles, birds, and then mammals. So for this purpose, if we see the evolution of horse, the evolution of horse give us a very good example of evolution. So the complete record of the horse is found in the North American sedimentary rocks from early Eocene period, which is about 56 to 34 million years ago. We see the classification of the horse. The horse belong to class Mammalia, order is Pisodactyla, family is Equidae, genus Equus, species is Equus ferus, and subspecies Equus ferus scabilis. So now we study the history of evolution of horse. So the prehistoric horse, the modern horse, is descendant of small primitive four-toed animal. So that stood only 4.5 feet high at the shoulder. Approximately 55 million years later, the modern horse, the Equus, evolved as the first true horse on the planet. Equus actually migrated from North America throughout the world, and fossil remains has been discovered now in Asia, in Europe, Africa, and throughout North and South America. The first Old World equid fossils were found in the gypsum quarries in Montmartre, Paris in 1820s by George Cuvier. So this fossil shows that this animal was browsing equid-like tapir. Tapir, it is a large herbivore mammal similar in shape to a pig, with a short prehensile nose and trunk, as we can see in this picture. In 1780s, O.C. Marsh, a U.S. paleontologist, he published description of newly discovered horse fossil from North America. Sequences from Eohippus, the primitive horse, to the modern horse was given by Thomas Huxley, a British biologist. Later, the American Museum of Natural History assembled exhibit of horse fossil to show gradual evolution of horse from Eohippus, that is Equus, to a modern model of straight line of evolution. G.G. Simpson, 1951, the first recognized that the modern horse was not the goal of the entire lineage of equids, but is simply the only genus of many horse lineages to survive. So according to him, that during the evolution, there were also different other genera there, but they could not survive the environmental conditions. So the modern horse, it was able to survive. So we can see a straight line of lineage. So for example, in this picture, we see in the Eocene period, Heracotherium, the most primitive grazer or browser animal, from which emerged different other ones, and then there is the Mesohippus, Merychippus, Paeohippus, and then modern Equus horse. So this is a linear lineage of the evolution of horse, starting from Heracotherium, Mesohippus, Merychippus, Paeohippus, and then modern Equus. So if we see over here, so this is the most primitive one, Heracotherium. So it is smaller in size. So we can see particularly the evolution is more evident in the evolution of their limbs. So here we can see there are four digits. So these digits, one of them is reduced. Now it has three, and one is more well developed. So then this one, the third digit is more developed and 2 and 4 started decreasing. And then in the modern horse, we can see only the single digit, third digit, which bear the weight of the body of the modern horse. So gradually the limbs, they evolved according to the need of the animal. If you see the characteristic of the modern horse, the neck and head is long and slender to minimize resistance while running. The skull is large and spacious brain box. Premolar are like molar with deep crown and adapted for grinding. Feet long and one toe. So such animals are called ungulates. Higher sense of intelligence. The animal is very intelligent, and radius and tibia are long while the humerus and femur are short. So radius is a bone in the forearm, and femur is a bone in the hind limb. So this is a femur in the hind limb, and this is a humerus in the forelimb. So they are short. So before elbow joint, this bone is short. And from elbow joint to the knee joint, so here is radius and ulna. It is large and very strong. Same is the case in the hind limb. The femur is short, starting from the hip bone to the knee joint. And from the knee joint to the ankle, this tibia, it is very large. So this tibia and this humerus, they bear the weight of the body of the animal. So they are very large and strong. And the back of the animal is also arched. Eohippus, so which was about 60 million years ago, it was like the size of a fox, about 25 to 45 centimeter in height. Skull and neck were short, the back was arched and flexible. The forelimbs and hind limbs possessed 4 and 3 digits respectively. Toes touched the ground, supported by a pad, and it was better adapted to walk on soft floor of the forest. So that time environment was in the form of a forest. So this animal was browsing on the forest. So dentition is also one of important evolutionary aspect. The dentition of this animal was brachiodont, that is low crown teeth, which were used to browse on the soft vegetation. And the cerebral hemisphere were small and smooth. So these were the characteristics of Eohippus, the most primitive type of horse. So this is the structure of this Eohippus. Then comes the Mesohippus, 35 to 40 million years ago. The size was a bit larger, like the size of a sheep, 45 to 60 centimeter in height. Neck was short, the back was more arched, and legs flexible. So then we can see adaptation in the toes. Toes in forelimbs and hind limb were reduced to 3. Toes touched the ground. Middle one was larger to bear most of the body weight. The feet had pad under the toe, showing beginning of the hoof. So from here it starts the beginning of the hoof. And dentition was still brachiodont. Molar still with low crown, used to browse on soft vegetation. And this animal was living in the forest. So it has a forest dwelling habitat. So whole body is adapted for this mode of life, the skeleton and particularly the dentition. And cerebral hemisphere were enlarged and convoluted, and brain had horse-like appearance. So these are the three major aspects. The change in the skeleton, particularly of the limbs, the dentition, and the development of the brain. So they are gradually developing from the primitive to the modern form. So here we can see the Mesohippus horse. So then comes the Merychippus. It was a ruminant horse 20 to 25 million years ago. So first three-toed grazer animal feeding on grass, and marks the transition from primitive browsing horse to modern grazing horse. So it had three toes, but second and fourth, the side toes were reduced and did not touch the ground. So they were raised from the ground. The foot pad was absent. So this animal is adapted to walk on comparatively hard ground. So this is because of change in the climatic condition or habitat of the animal. Dentition also changed. It become hypsodont. The teeth were with high crown. And cerebral hemispheres were large and convoluted with fishes resembling the modern horse. So there are gradual changes in the skeleton, in the dentition, and also in the brain. So here we can see the Merychippus ruminant horse. So we can see the changes in the skeleton of the limbs. Then come the Pliohippus horse. So 5 to 23 million years ago. So this was the first one-toothed horse whose fossil remains are found from Miocene and Pliocene period. The sitos, second and fourth, greatly reduced. Size of the modern pony increased about 100 centimeters. The crowns of upper molar were similar to the modern horse. It increased in complexity of the molars because it has to now graze on the hard type of the grasses. So there were gradual changes in their dentition. Increase in pre-orbital length of the skull. So orbits are the spaces where we have our eyes. So pre-orbital space was increased in the skull. So here we can see the Pliohippus horse. And then came the modern horse, which is known as Equus. So it originated around 5 million years ago. So it increased in size up to 150 centimeter in height. Fourth and fifth digits were entirely lost in this animal. Entire body weight is now on the third digit alone. So this condition is also called monodactyle. So only the third digits bear the whole weight of the body. So animal has long legged and it is swift running animal. Crown of the molars are elongated and are adapted to crush the dry and the harsh grasses. Enlarged brain and cerebellar hemispheres have grooved surface. So this is the modern horse. It has highly developed skeleton. It has highly developed dentition and brain is also well developed. So this is the modern horse or the Equus. So the evolution trend main which we see in the evolution of horse, that was reduction in the tools because it has to adopt swift running mode of life. So the toes gradually reduced and the only single third digit is converted into the hoof, which add in running. Elongation of leg by standing on the toes. So long legs were elongated, particularly its radius and its tibia, they are well developed. The animal has increased body size. Elongation of the muzzle. Muzzles are the mouth parts which it use for grazing the grass. There is elongation so it can graze the grasses, and high crown specialized teeth are there for crushing such type of the grasses. So here we can see the evolutionary trend of the limbs particularly. So gradually from Araucanthium to Equus, if we see there is gradual increase in the size and reduction in the toes. This third digit is becoming hard and well developed, and in the Equus it is converted into the hoof. So here we can see gradual increase in the size of the bones and reduction in the toes from primitive horse to the modern horse. Environmental causes for evolutionary trend in the horse. So environment is a selective force which forces the animal to change. So need for greater speed and body size to escape from the predators. Simple hooves and elongated legs adapted for running in the open places. So due to the cooling climate during Cenozoic era, so forests were replaced with the grasslands. So elongated muzzle was needed to reach the grasses. So animal modified its mouth parts, its muzzle. High crown teeth adapted for grasses with high in silica. So as the forest was converted into the grasslands, grasslands have grasses which have silica, so high ground was evolved. High ground so that enamel won't erode by eating the grasses. So if we see the evolution in the tooth structure, the lifespan of an individual is limited by length of time its teeth remain sound and useful. So animal is able to feed. Blades of grasses have tiny spicules of silica. Chewing such grasses quickly wear out the low crown teeth. So horses have hypsodont dentition, that they have a high crown allowing them to use tougher food sources. Increased number of the cusps help in grinding. So particularly the molars and premolars, they have increased cusps. So these cusps are used for grinding of the hard and tough grasses. Presence of cementum increase the hardness of the tooth and also create ridges on the surface of the tooth, which aid in more effective grinding of the grasses. So here we can see the gradual changes in the dentition from the primitive horse to the modern horse, particularly its molars and premolars. They become more and more hard and tough, and they have a lot of cusps which are used for grinding of the food. So gradually the skull is also increasing. The bones of the limbs, they are also increasing. If you see the forelimb and also the hind limb, they are also gradually increasing, and same is the case with the tooth. So in the skeleton we can see that the skull, the forelimb, the hind limb and the dentition, the teeth, so there is gradual increase, and this is adapted to mode of the life which the horse was adopting. So these are few other helping links, so which you can use for further information. Thank you very much.